Hey, everyone. Thanks for attending our grand rounds today. We welcome back Dr. Nick Mark, who's a pulmonary and critical care doc from Swedish Medical Center in Seattle. Nick has a very large presence on Twitter at Nick M. Mark, where he regularly breaks down very complicated issues facing the medical community into very understandable bite-sized pieces. And many of those he publishes on his website. You can see on his title slide there, One Pager ICU. He's talked to us a few times now during the course of the pandemic, most recently about this debate around ivermectin. And he's back today to help us understand what's going on with our new variant. And I will defer saying its name until Nick corrects my pronunciation. Anyways, everyone welcome Nick. And Nick, go ahead and get started.
Well, thank you. Thank you again for that kind introduction, Matt. My pleasure to be back speaking with you all. Over the last few weeks, I think we've all seen the media coverage unfold. We've seen headlines like nations shaken. We've heard talk of fears, setbacks, and leave it to the New York Post to really go for the gold. Oh my God, not again. But I think in this case, the fear is really not helping us. And in putting together this talk, I was pondering just how little we know about Omicron. And I was reminded of a quote by John Glenn, who said, "You fear the least what you know the most about." And while I think it's natural to fear the unknown, and there are many unknowns about Omicron, my hope is that by learning about Omicron together over the next 30 minutes, we can reduce that fear just a little bit. What I'd like to do is I'd like to look at Omicron through three lenses: molecularly, epidemiologically, and clinically. Specifically, we can talk about the mutations present in Omicron and why they might be significant. We'll talk about the rapidity and breadth of its spread around the world. And we'll conclude by discussing what we know about its clinical course and the implications for vaccines and treatments. I have no conflicts of interest in relation to this talk, but one important caveat is that our understanding of this variant is evolving rapidly. The sources that I'm going to cite are mostly preprints, press releases, and open source databases. Few of these are peer reviewed. I've done my best to fact check everything that we're going to talk about and make sure this content is accurate. And I think it is accurate as of December 17th, 2021. But I just want to stress that this is a fast evolving field and our understanding of this variant is likely to change over the coming months. Now, before we get into the molecular basis of what this variant is, we should probably talk about pronunciation. So according to Google and several dictionaries, Omicron is the American version and Omicron is the British version. If you actually dive a little deeper though, this is a bit of a simplification. So confusingly, the Greek alphabet actually has two letters that are pronounced almost exactly the same. This letter, the last letter in the Greek alphabet, makes an oo sound. The Greeks called it big O or omega. On the other hand, this letter, the 15th letter of the Greek alphabet, makes an o sound. The Greeks called this little o or omicron. So thus, while either pronunciation is fine, and I'm probably going to use both interchangeably in this talk, technically, I think Omicron is probably the correct one. So if you're looking to correct somebody over the holiday, you can cite this here. Now that we've got that crucial pronunciation bit out of the way, let's talk about the process whereby we understand what a variant is and how we describe new variants. So I want you to imagine that somebody comes to you in clinic, they have symptoms, you decide to test them for COVID. That's done at your local lab. If this person tests positive, that sample can be sent on to a larger public health laboratory for sequencing. Now, most samples are not sequenced. The number varies quite a bit from country to country. Just to give you some examples of that, in Iceland, they sequence 455 out of every 1,000 cases. So almost half of isolates get sequenced. In the UK, it's about 1 in 8. In the US, we're achieving about 3% overall. And in South Africa, where most of this story is unfolding, about half of 1%, or about 5 sequences per 1,000 positives, end up getting tested. Once those genomes are sequenced, they're uploaded to open databases. And the two to emphasize are the NCBI's GenBank and GISET, which is the Global Initiative on Sharing Avian Influenza Data. Now, as that name suggests, it was formed in 2008 to address avian flu, but it's since taken on this massive importance in the time of COVID. So once the data is there, it can be picked up by lots of different platforms and researchers. And some of these platforms are really worth emphasizing, and a lot of what we're going to talk about today comes from them. So there are platforms such as NextStrain, Covariants, and Cove Lineages. These are where some of those names like B11529 gets assigned. It's also very useful to sort of lift up the hood and show you how this process works. The other thing that this data can be used for is it can be used by researchers to make in silico models of the structure of the virus. And that helps understand how its function might be changed and how our immune response to it might differ. I want to emphasize that in order for us to adapt to a changing pandemic, we need this open data pipeline. And it's really only because of South Africa's participation in this, their voluntary participation, that we have the advanced knowledge that we do about Omicron. So to demonstrate what this looks like, I'm going to use NextStrain to show you how we can look at GISET data. So here we have a plot showing different isolates over time, beginning on the left with the Wuhan sequence. And each one of those dots represents one person who was sequenced. As we move through time, you can see the emergence of variants. The alpha variant, the beta variant, the delta variant, which became dominant worldwide, and you can see there's a lot of it. And then finally, in October, November 2021, we see the emergence of this cluster in Botswana and South Africa. This was classified as 21K by NextStrain, 11529 using Covariant's Pango tool, and then on November 26th, the WHO classified it as a variant of concern, and they gave it the Greek letter Omicron. So doubtless, you've also heard that this is a highly mutated variant. So we can actually use this same tool to look at the number of mutations over time. And you can see number of mutations is now on the horizontal axis. You can see that alpha and beta are mutated compared to the Wuhan version. The delta variant is more mutated still. And then Omicron is a little bit more mutated. But I want to emphasize that the key is not the number of mutations. It's really where in the virus all these mutations lie and what they're doing. And so in order to do that, we're going to have to jump into another open tool. So here we have data from covariants. We can see that the SARS-CoV-2 genome, which is actually one of the largest RNA viruses, it's almost 30 kilobases, it encodes 29 proteins. The Omicron variant has about 30 mutations, but they're not evenly distributed. Well, there's some in all of the genes, but most of them are clustered here in the spike glycoprotein. And this is really key to understanding what makes Omicron different and why so many people are so worried about it. So if we look closer at the spike glycoprotein, so you see it over here in my picture on the left, and we can actually like look at it, we can sort of zoom in and look at it structurally now. So this is a visualization by Ulrich Elling. He posted this on Twitter, and it just beautifully illustrates the Delta variant on the left and the Omicron variant on the right. And you can see where all of those different mutations fall in the virus's structure. Now, the reason why we're so interested in the spike protein is because it covers the outside of the virus. And this is one of the primary things that the immune system, specifically antibodies, interacts with. It's also the primary means that the virus uses to get into cells. So changes in the structure and function of the spike protein could dramatically change what the virus does and how we're able to respond to it. Now, if we look at these mutations a little more closely, we see that if there's 50 mutations in the variant and 30 of them are in the spike protein, fully half of those, 15, are right here in the receptor binding domain. So there's definitely going to be some changes in its ability to bind to its receptor, ACE2. This could potentially increase transmissibility, as we'll see. Other mutations here could potentially change the way antibodies interact with it. And it could be there's potential for immune or antibody evasion. There's a few other things that you may see people talking about. So this cluster of mutations here has previously been described as a furin cleavage site mutation. Furin is a host enzyme, it's one of our enzymes that several different viruses use to change glycoprotein structure. And it turns out that without furin, the virus can't infect our cells. And with even small changes in the furin cleavage site, the virus can become more transmissible. There's also changes in the area that mediates binding to ACE2. These bindings these changes are predicted to increase its affinity for ACE2 and increase transmissibility. And then finally, one last thing I want to emphasize are these two deletions here. So you may hear about you may hear about something called S gene target failure, or SGTF. What's going on here is that one of the PCR tests that's widely used to test for COVID amplifies these residues right here, or the sequences right here. And so in Omicron, those are absent, and it causes that gene not to amplify. So this is basically used as a poor man's Omicron test, because other sequences do amplify, the S gene doesn't. And so this is a tweet from one of the people at UW Virology who documents this increase in cases we're seeing here in Seattle. And what they're doing is they're using S gene target failure as a quick and dirty way to detect Omicron before the sequencing data comes back. So if you see your microbiology lab is reporting S gene dropout or S gene target failure, this is what it means, and this is why it's useful. So fortunately, because these sequences are widely available, the researchers in the US and around the world didn't have to wait until the virus came to their area. They could start working with it immediately, even when it was located just in South Africa and Botswana. And that's given us a tremendous leg up in understanding what the virus does and how our immune system responds to it. So this is a group that built upon their prior work where they'd identified CD8 T cell receptors that bind to SARS-CoV-2. And what they did was they looked at the sequence of the Omicron spike protein. That's this text here on the left. Every one of those is an amino acid. They show the mutations that are unique to Omicron in blue, and they show the sequences, the epitopes that T cells react to in green. And the key point here is that most of the T cell epitopes that the immune system sees are completely unaffected by Omicron. In fact, not only was 7 out of 8 unaffected by mutation, but it turns out that the one where there was a mutation in the T cell epitope is relatively minor. And that low abundance TCR probably does not contribute very much to the immune response. So the authors conclude, based on this sequence data that they were able to get from South Africa, these data suggest that virtually all individuals with existing anti-SARS-CoV-2 CD8 T cell responses should recognize the Omicron variant of concern. It also suggests that the virus has not evolved extensive T cell escape mechanisms at this point. This is very good news. Now, not all of the news is good, though. On the other hand, another group looked at infectivity, and their results were a little more worrisome. So Garcia Beltran et al. In this preprint used spike protein sequences to construct pseudoviruses, and they used those pseudovirus particles to infect ACE2 expressing cells in a dish. And what they found was that compared to wild type, the Omicron variant, shown here in purple, had 4-fold higher infectivity in vitro. They also found that it was twice as infectious as the already more infectious Delta variant. So this increase in infectivity is very worrisome in vitro. And when we see some of the data about how it's spread in vivo, I think this portends that the virus really, really truly is more transmissible. To illustrate that, this is an event that occurred in Oslo, Norway. So on November 26th, a traveler who was returning from South Africa attended a corporate Christmas party at this fancy restaurant pictured here. The person was vaccinated and asymptomatic at the time. Everybody at the party was also vaccinated. But ultimately, of the 120 people who attended, as many as 90 tested positive. This suggests a very high attack rate, which is worrisome. And even more worrisomely, other people who were at the restaurant who were not at the party also became infected with Omicron. This suggests that at least in an unmasked indoor gathering, the virus is quite transmissible. Importantly, though, and this is something we'll harp on a couple of times, all of the attendees were vaccinated and none required hospitalization. So this is kind of a hint that maybe the immune system is still reacting to this virus. Now, we can see the same thing playing out on a national scale. So earlier this week, we got this treasure trove of data from Discovery Health, which is South Africa's largest private insurer. They included over 200,000 COVID test results that spanned all four of the waves of COVID that South Africa has experienced during the pandemic. So looking at their data, both the daily cases by wave and the weekly test positivity rate, there's a really striking trend here. We can see that daily cases and test positivity have spiked much faster with the Omicron wave shown in brown than in the prior three waves. So this provides population level evidence that fits with that in vitro and case study evidence to suggest that the Omicron really is more transmissible. We can also use some of those genomics platforms to look at this, and we can see how Omicron is spreading. So if you look here at the map, you can see that the earlier variants are identified in one place and then they're identified somewhere else. And we can watch that spread over time. And you can see that in first the alpha, beta variants became dominant in one place and then spread somewhere else. And then in summer 2020, Delta really became dominant. Delta's green. And you can see Delta became the primary strand worldwide. But now look what happens with Omicron. You could see that Omicron very quickly went from just a few cases to present globally. And it's not ignore the size. The size is not the key thing here. The key thing is the rapidity of that spread. You can see how in a time span of days to weeks, Omicron has gone from an infection in just two countries in Africa to in many more countries. Adding to this, so this is data from GISAID. So what they're looking at here is they're looking at the percent of sequences that they get from a country or a region, how many of them are Omicron. And I updated this just like 30 minutes ago. So this is pretty much up to the minute data. They found that since the beginning of November, Omicron has gone from essentially nothing to over 60% of isolates in Africa. According to them, as of this morning, Omicron sequences have been submitted from 69 different countries worldwide. All of this together, the case study, the in vitro data, and the sequencing data is strong evidence that Omicron is indeed more transmissible and is poised to become the dominant strain worldwide. Now, if I stop the presentation right here, this would be deeply concerning and we would all freak out. But fortunately, we also have some clinical data from South Africa that maybe tempers this worry somewhat. So this is more data from Discovery Health showing the percent change in cases, hospital admissions, and deaths by week. And what I want to illustrate here is, so you can see on the left, that's the Delta surge that occurred this last summer. All three curves went up. In contrast, if you look at the last 3 weeks of data on the right, you can see that the curves have become uncoupled. Infections are rising, but hospitalizations and deaths aren't. Now, this is early. We only have 3 weeks of data. There may be a lag in either people getting sick or hospitals reporting that. But This is an early sign that despite a large surge in cases, there do indeed appear to be fewer hospitalizations and deaths. The Financial Times did a similar analysis in the Gauteng region. This is the region in South Africa that's essentially been the epicenter of the Omicron variant. They found that in contrast to the Delta variant, despite a surge in Omicron cases, there were actually fewer patients who were COVID positive in ICUs or requiring mechanical ventilation. So once again, only a few weeks of data, right? Not even 30 days shown here, but this is an encouraging early sign. Discovery Health also shared some anecdotal data collected by clinicians who were treating patients with Omicron COVID in South Africa. They noted that among outpatients, they saw more breakthrough infections, a shorter incubation period, and what they characterized as a milder illness. Now, I want to be really, really careful describing this as mild, because I think there's some important caveats on that. We'll talk more about that in a second, but just remember, the plural of anecdote is not evidence. And just because outpatients with this had a milder course doesn't mean that it is a milder disease. They also report some data among hospitalized patients, and they said that the overwhelming majority of patients, both in the hospital and in the ICU, were unvaccinated. And they point out that vaccinated patients were much less likely to require supplemental oxygen. So this is interesting news. We could look at this as good news, but it's not all great. And this is the piece of data that makes me pretty uncomfortable. So one note of caution was the apparent increase in hospitalizations for children. So you see here, age are the different columns. The 0 to 4 year old children, there were actually more hospital admissions for children under 5 than there were for adults in this latest wave. And that's very different than what we've seen in all the prior waves, both in South Africa and worldwide. So as a father of 2 kids who are both under 5, this slide probably makes me the most uncomfortable thinking about COVID. Now, one question that we need to ask ourselves is Omicron mild or are the vaccines working? Now, superficially, if you look at the data about South Africa, you see something like only 26% are fully vaccinated. So how could the vaccines be working? But I want to emphasize that South Africa is a little bit atypical, in part because they were hit so hard by the Delta wave and those earlier waves. There was one study that was done before the Omicron wave where they found that 72% of people in the Gauteng region were seropositive. So this suggests to me that even though only a minority are fully vaccinated, the majority actually do have prior immunity. And so when we see proclamations like the disease is mild, we really have to know mild for whom. People with prior immunity may have partial protection. And there's a couple pieces of evidence that support that. So the observation that most hospitalized patients were unvaccinated, most patients in ICU were unvaccinated, and that children who were too young to have gotten vaccinated disproportionately seemed to be affected. Now, Discovery Health actually modeled this. Oh, I think the question we really ought to be asking ourselves is not, are the vaccines working, but is immunity working? So Discovery Health actually modeled this. And what they found was that people who had received 2 doses of the Pfizer vaccine had about 33% protection against infection, but they had 70% protection against hospitalization. So my conclusion is that while Omicron may be slightly more mild, most of that is actually due to the fact that most of the people in South Africa had prior immunity or were vaccinated. There's some other evidence that supports the efficacy of vaccines and specifically boosted vaccines in protecting against serious Omicron infection. So this is that Garcia Beltran preprint that we looked at earlier. They looked at sera from people who had been vaccinated with each of the 3 vaccines, and they exposed that sera to pseudovirus particles, and they measured its ability to neutralize those particles. So what they found was people who had received a 3rd dose of the mRNA 1273 or the Moderna vaccine had 19-fold higher neutralization if they'd been boosted, if they'd gotten three doses instead of two. Similarly, they found that people who had received a third dose of the BioNTech 162B or Pfizer vaccine had 27-fold higher neutralizing titers if they had gotten a third dose. They even found that people who'd received one dose of the J&J vaccine, shown in green, followed by an mRNA dose, had fourfold higher titers. So this suggests to me that susceptibility to Omicron may have less to do with immune evasion and more to do with the fact that titers drop over time, and that people who get boosted actually have strong protective antibody titers. This is a study that was done, a population study that was done in the UK to try to address the question of timing. So this was a case control study where they cross-referenced two national databases. One was a national database of COVID testing results, and the other was a national database of vaccination records. And they used this to calculate the VE or vaccine effectiveness at different time points. What they found was that the vaccine effectiveness for Delta, shown in black, and Omicron, shown in gray, were actually comparable at about 85% in people who were 2 to 9 weeks after their second dose. But the vaccine effectiveness declined to about 35% among people who were more than 6 months out from that second dose. They also found that among people who had received a booster, the vaccine effectiveness against both Delta and Omicron rose again, reaching almost 80% once again. So my conclusion is that getting a third dose, either because of the additional dose or maybe just because of a more recent dose, really does seem to be highly effective at increasing your titers and increasing vaccine effectiveness at preventing symptomatic infection. So to summarize all of this, molecularly, we know that Omicron harbors several spike protein mutations that do seem to enhance its transmissibility. And this is borne out by epidemiologic data that shows that Omicron has spread rapidly and worldwide. I think based on what we've seen, it is likely to continue to do so. It's already here in the US, and it will likely become the dominant strain in the US and Europe as it has in Africa. But I think there is a ray of sunshine here, which is that clinically, Omicron may cause less serious disease, at least among people with prior immunity. We also have good evidence that despite increased transmissibility, vaccines still work. T cell responses are still intact, and boosters seem to restore titers and restore neutralization, which is likely protective against the infection. I also want to emphasize that this really teaches us the importance of global collaboration and information sharing. Just imagine the difference between those early waves of the pandemic and the current wave. We know so much more now. So I want to loop back to where we started and, you know, remind you that hopefully by learning and demystifying Omicron, we've reduced our fear of it somewhat. So thank you very much for your attention. It's a privilege to be here with all of you. Look forward to your questions in the 1 minute we have left.
All right, thanks, Nick. I think I can summarize the questions pretty easily. The first was, you know, based off your discussion of the S gene dropout, is there any data about the sensitivity and specificity changes of the rapid antigen tests? Would those be affected?
I haven't seen any evidence that they don't work. I was trying to find something on that. It's not quite as clear, but I think that many of those are polyclonal antibodies that react to the spike antigen. And so even if some of the antibodies in the test are affected, others aren't. So I haven't seen any evidence that we don't have reliable antigen testing for it.
Okay. And then I'll summarize the next two by they're kind of similar. First off, has there been any data reported about the R-naught or sort of the contagiousness of Omicron? And then more broadly, is that sort of a natural evolutionary step for most pandemic viruses?
So those are great questions. So I didn't include evidence on R-naught because I think, you know, according to some experts, it's pretty unreliable when we're this early, that it just, the numbers tend to be kind of noisy. So I've seen estimates that are as high as 6. I don't know that I trust those. I think we're going to have to wait a few more weeks before we have a reliable R-naught number. Similarly, I think if we were to calculate an attack rate, it would look really high. I'm not sure what the actual attack rate is going to be. Especially like a household attack rate. So I think it's too early to know those numbers. As to the second part of that question, which I think is the question on all of our minds, does this represent a natural evolutionary step in a pandemic becoming an endemic, right? The transition to a more infectious, more transmissible, but perhaps less severe variant? It could be. It could not be. I think, you know, I would really caution that even though this appears to be a little bit milder in vaccinated people, it's much more transmissible, and there's still potential for that to overwhelm our health system. So that doesn't seem like something becoming endemic and no longer being a major issue. The second point is that we don't know what future mutations it will acquire. So I think we need to be really cautious. You know, the fact that this is more infectious and has outcompeted some other variants, I think that's bad news. I wouldn't look at this as a natural step or like the pandemic is ending. I would look at this as a strong reason to encourage people to get vaccinated or to get boosted. Maybe we should even start calling boosted getting a third dose, not boosted.
Right. Well, thank you, Nick. I think we're out of time, and I really appreciate you joining us once again. And I'm sure we'll call on you again in the future to give another one of these talks. It was great.